Hey, what's up, Grio fam? It's your girl, Shana Pinnock, social media director here at TheGrio.com, and this is Grio Top 3, powered by Dear Culture Podcast, where yours truly is one of your co-hosts alongside our managing editor, Jaron Keith Gaynor. But here on Grio Top 3, we give you the top 3 trending stories for the day. So let's get to it. Coming in at number 3, Black Twitter drags Justin Bieber over Locs hairstyle. Almost 5 years to the date since the first time it happened, pop star Justin Bieber is, yet again, being dragged through the streets of Black Twitter because of his hairstyle. The Peaches singer recently debuted his new look on his Instagram page, and, of course, it was met with a swift reaction on social media, with many calling out the singer for cultural appropriation. Now, if you recall, this isn't the first time the Biebs has made this ill-begotten hair choice. In April 2016, he faced a ton of backlash for doing the exact same thing. The conversation was so pervasive that he even eventually made a public comment on the backlash, telling rapper Big Sean at the iHeartRadio Music Awards, "People say you want to be black and all that stuff. I'm like, it's just my hair." Which, that's the problem, Justin. It isn't your hair. It is not meant to look like that. It also doesn't help that Bieber is still in the throes of backlash regarding his latest album, Justice, in which the singer used samples of speeches by Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. throughout several tracks on his album that, confusingly, had nothing to do with social justice or activism. Seriously. On one of the tracks titled Too Much, there's a sort of prologue wherein you hear MLK's voice saying the infamous words, "Injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere." That then leads into a completely unrelated love song dedicated to Justin Bieber's wife, Hailey. Granted, the samples were cleared by the King family, but even Justin's explanation that he gave on the Clubhouse app about the inclusion of MLK on the LP was pretty tone deaf and confusing. He said, quote, "I'm not trying to make a connection between me and Martin Luther King. That's why I never try to talk about social injustice, or I didn't want to be the one to talk about it, because I just have so much more learning to do. But I have this man who was ready to die in what he believed to be true. If I'm not willing to face some sort of ridicule or judgment of people wondering my motives or whatever that is, for me, it was a no-brainer." I think the words no-brain is where everything begins and ends for me. Now, back to Justin's hair. I just want to pull over and park here with a PSA of my own. Dear white people, your hair is not meant for locks. It isn't. We know this because it doesn't grow that way. And you have to put a whole lot of things in it to even try to maintain that matted mess in your head, which, let's be clear, those are not locks. It's just matted clumps of hair, and it doesn't look good. Never, ever. Nope, not even then. If anything, it makes you look like some unwashed bohemian with filthy feet. Stick to the mullets and buzz cuts that you're used to. We beg of you. Sincerely, black people everywhere. Now at number 2, Michael Jackson's likeness valued at $4.1 million in legal win for estate. Michael Jackson's estate has scored a legal victory in a years-long battle with the IRS over the value of the late singer's assets and image at the time of his 2009 death. As we here at The Grio previously reported, the initial dispute centered on the King of Pop's image as well as his recording legacy. Jackson's lawyers essentially said, when it came to the IRS and the value of Jackson's estate at the time of his death, the math wasn't mathin'. The IRS claimed that Jackson's estate owed $700 million in unpaid taxes and penalties, and that the singer's likeness was valued at $434 million. However, lawyers of his estate said the taxable value of the singer's image and likeness was worth just $2,105, claiming the late singer's many controversies, his odd behavior, and the allegations of child sexual abuse, alongside his financial mismanagement, cut the worth of his assets significantly. This week, U.S. tax court judge Mark Holmes issued a more than 250-page ruling that put the taxable figure at $111 million and determined that the singer's likeness was valued at approximately $4.15 million at the time of his death. Judge Holmes noted, quote, "From the time he was a child, Michael Jackson was famous, and there were times in his life, testified his executor, when he was the most famous person in the world. There were certainly years when he was the most well-known popular music star, and even after his death, there have been years where he was the world's highest earning entertainer. But there was also many years when he was more famous for his unusual behavior and not his unusual talent. And there were some years where his fame was turned infamous by serious accusations of the most noisome acts. The fact that he earned not a penny from his image and likeness in 2006, 2007, or 2008 shows the effect the child abuse allegations had and continue to have until his death. It's also interesting that Judge Holmes also took issue with the estate's $2,105 figure, stating that ruling the estate at such a meager amount was, quote, valuing the image and likeness of one of the best known celebrities in the world, the King of Pop, at the price of a heavily used 20-year-old Honda Civic. At any rate, if you're confused about all the numbers, just know this is a win for the Jackson estate, as well as Michael Jackson's three children. Finally, at number one, Rep. Bobby Rush introduces bill forcing FBI to release Fred Hampton files. Democratic Rep. Bobby Rush of Illinois, who also was the co-founder of the Illinois Black Panther Party, has introduced a bill mandating the disclosure of secret FBI files related to the death of Chairman Fred Hampton. In a letter to Attorney General Merrick Garland, Rush requested, quote, that you release unclassified and unredacted versions of any files or papers in the possession of the U.S. Department of Justice or the FBI pertaining to this assassination. Thanks to the buzz created by the film Judas and the Black Messiah, starring Daniel Kaluuya and Lakeith Stanfield, portraying the government-sanctioned murder of 21-year-old Fred Hampton by the FBI in December 1969, many have demanded answers from the federal agency about the role it played in the snuffing out of the young leader's life. In his letter, Rep. Rush also wrote to AG Garland, quote, we believe that it is past time that our country fully knows and understands its dark past, and the release and study of this information is an important step on this journey. The American people know about the odious and inhumane legacy of J. Edgar Hoover's COINTELPRO operation and its assault on our nation's civil liberties. COINTELPRO was spying on American citizens. Anyone who took a political position against the status quo, anyone who wanted to make America better, was subject to being penalized, investigated, and in the case of my friend, Fred Hampton, assassinated by the official legal arm of the federal government. It's important to note that Rep. Rush's bill would also require the FBI to release all files related to now disbanded counterintelligence programs, including those related to the Black Panther Party and Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. It would also remove J. Edgar Hoover's name from the FBI headquarters in Washington, D.C., as the former FBI leader devised and carried out COINTELPRO. I don't know about you, Grio fam, but I'm hoping the light is soon shed on all of the activities Hoover and the rest of his FBI lackeys were engaged in. It's vital if we're going to have some semblance of transparency for the American people. So thank you, Rep. Rush, for making sure that we all can be a revolutionary. Well, this has been Grio Top 3, powered by Dear Culture Podcast. Please subscribe to our YouTube channel at youtube.com/TheGrio and the Dear Culture Podcast wherever you listen to podcasts. See you soon.